Hi, my name is Jason Cox. We're here with the Oral History Project for the City of Keyser Points of Interest Committee. Our very first guest is Evelyn Franz, who I believe is a lifelong resident of Keyser. Is that right?
True, yes.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about when you were born and kind of the family homestead. I understand you guys had a big farm right out near River Road.
Yes, my father bought this 35-acre farm at the end of River Road and Cherry Avenue, now where it's called Keyser Town Square. And we moved out in October of 1926.
So how old were you at the time?
6 years old.
Do you remember the move to Keyser at
all?
Oh,
yes. Very nice.
So I understand, when you say River Road, was it actually... It was a dirt road at the time, wasn't it?
Not River Road. River Road was just a single patched road, however, mm-hmm. not like it is now. And Cherry Avenue was a graveled road that intersected at River Road.
Now, your maiden name was Melson.
Melson, yes.
And how long did your family own the farm there?
Well, they bought it in 1926 and then until 1961.
What did they grow there?
Just about everything. There was a prune orchard was the main thing. We had cherry orchard. We had wonderful gardens, all kinds of fruits. We had a swale and a pasture, and then the Claygate Creek at the east side of the property.
So they moved there just a few short years before the Great Depression started.
Yes.
How did that affect your family?
Well, as a youngster... It didn't affect me because here where I was on this wonderful acreage, we had all these wonderful fruits, and we had cows, horses, pigs, chickens, self-sufficient almost. But, of course, it was hard for my older brother and older sister because of entering. They were in high school and college in those years, and it was hard for them. But otherwise... We weathered it pretty well.
So describe for me the drive. You said you were at the River Road and Cherry Avenue, kind of where they intersect.
Mm-hmm.
And the house was a bit set back from the road.
Yes.
What did it look like as you came in?
The house was a two-story farmhouse. I think, according to what I found out, I think it was the original John Forrest donation land claim house. And it was quite... They had a barn and another house beside it, and there was a prune dryer and a rabbit tree. It was quite a farm.
So your father, he was a farmer, was he?
No, my father was not a farmer. I look back now, I would call him a gentleman farmer. My father owned the Atlas Bookstore in Salem at the time.
Mm-hmm.
He was also a politician later, county commissioner for 8 years, and a businessman. And he bought this farm, and I'm glad he did. And then he maintained his ties in Salem with everything and then farmed on weekends and evenings. So he wasn't exactly, quote-unquote, a farmer.
So who were some of your family friends growing up? Who did your family spend time with?
Well, our family friends, one was Terry Hogue, who was a member of the Points of Interest Committee. Her mother, Oral Smith, was a friend. Sylvia Claygate of the Claygate family, an old Keyser family. And the Blake family that had Willow Lake, they were friends.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bowden family, which is an old family, and the Frogley family, which is an old first families of Keyser. Because Keyser was just big farms when we moved out, mostly, at that time.
When did you... Do you remember when you started to see, you know, obviously it's not a farm... corridor anymore.
No.
What was it, when did you really remember starting to see the transition?
After
sort of?
World War II.
So when did you, what were some of the businesses that started popping up that you
well,
remember?
Well, the first one, well, of course, the very, well, very first business, if you want to call it that, was Ward Russell's little gas station. He sold bread and candy and things by the old school. But just before the war, there at the intersection of Cherry Avenue and River Road, there was a Union gas station, and behind it was Smith and Ward Grocery and Hardware Store at the intersection. That must have been the late 30s. Yes, just before Pearl Harbor, 41.
What was, what do you remember from, who were your schoolmates at Kaiser School that you remembered?
Well, Sylvia Claggett, Eileen Holden Johnson, Zilla Frogley Schooley, and there's Lorraine's son. Her father had the peach orchard where Fred Myers is now. And Phil Blake, a lot of the old first family children who were my age.
So do you attended Kaiser School then, correct?
All 8 years.
Who was your favorite teacher there?
Well, let's see, favorite. I can't really say. I had four teachers.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about some of them?
Yes. My friend Eileen Holden Johnson, her mother was a first grade teacher. My third and fourth grade teacher was Cora Clark Beardsley. And then in the fifth and sixth grade was Eva Kelso. And in the seventh and eighth was Janet Kirk.
So when World War II or when Pearl Harbor happened, you would have been, how old would you have been?
Well, let's see, I was married in 1940, and that was in 41. I was 20.
Did your husband end up going?
He went to officer's candidate school. He volunteered. Mm-hmm.
How do you remember the atmosphere? What do you remember about Kaiser during the war?
Let's see. Well, I had my first child in 43. Well, things changed. It's hard to tell. Well, you didn't have things. You couldn't get a refrigerator or a washer. Rationing went into effect, and sugar and butter and all those things. You had little coupons. I still have those little books at home that showed how to. Things started changing, and it just changed so gradually. You didn't notice it because everything was changing, mm-hmm. It seemed like.
So there was, do you remember when did you go to school with any Japanese children from
the
area?
Oh, yes. We had quite a few Japanese children in our grades. I have pictures of them in the classroom pictures, the Fukudas, the Watanabes, and two girls. Yes, we had several. Mm-hmm. They came from Lake Labish.
Uh-huh. Do you remember how that community was affected in the months after Pearl Harbor?
Lake Labish?
Mm-hmm. The Japanese community.
Well, of course, they were interned, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure, well, I was so busy raising a family then, I didn't really pay too much attention to that.
Sure.
To tell you the truth. But they were affected, of course. Some never did get over it, of course.
What businesses did your family like to go to a lot when you were a kid, a child, and as a young adult? What businesses did you frequent?
Of course, it was during the Depression, and then like our family, mother canned everything and did her own baking and cooking. So I think about the only time we went to businesses buy fresh meat, probably,
mm-hmm.
because I can't remember having any canned goods hardly those years.
How did your family, so you were a young mother when the war was happening.
Yes.
How did you manage to, was it living off the land more or less?
No. I say, well, it's hard to explain. I hadn't thought through too much. Well, coming from the Depression, you just got what you needed, not what you wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So when the rationing came on and everything, it just was kind of an extension of not having things. So everybody was in the same boat. So we just all kind of weathered it, kind of went along with it the way it was.
One of the committee members told me you used to roller skate to school.
Yes. River Road was a combination of patches and cement, I guess, and tar. Mm-hmm. Or they'd patch. Lorraine's son would come from her house. I say they lived near where Fred Myers her roller skates, and then I'd be waiting at the end of the lane on mine, mm-hmm. and then we'd roller skate down to Kaiser School. No cars, believe it or not, because all the teachers were already there by 8 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And then others would come from Willark Park, which is now Willark Park. They'd come from there on their roller skates, and sometimes we'd just roller skate around a while. But the tar, when it was cold, was so smooth and nice. Roller skating wasn't really much fun, but it was roller skating. And, of course, our skates weren't like they have now.
Did the road ice over more in the winter then?
I always walked to school. It seemed like it was always raining, more or less. I can't ever remember having any problems with, what was the ice?
So let's talk about Kaiser right after World War II. Mm-hmm. People are coming home and new businesses. And you said your family sold the farm in 61?
No. We sold the farm in 61. But my father started subdividing it before that. And he sold the first part off to Berg's Grocery Store, where Kaiser Town Square is now.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the first in the early 1950s.
What did you think at the time of sort of selling the farm off kind of
business? Well, I was busy with my family, and that was my father's business or whatever it was, and so I didn't really get involved too much or think too much about it,
mm-hmm.
tell you the truth.
Do you ever, when you're in that neighborhood, think this, do you ever see spots like, this used to be where we would play, you know, or something
like
that?
Oh, yes.
Can you give me any examples?
Well, I go through that quite a bit. And, of course, the end of the property bordered Claggett Creek, and it was on a kind of a knoll, a lot of oak trees. And afternoons I would walk from the house or ride my horse down to there and play in those woods and along the creek, because it was hot days, it was really nice down there. And when I go by there a lot, I think, I wonder what that looks like now. Houses.
So tell me a little bit about yourself. So we've talked about Kaiser quite a bit and what the area was like. You had a young family coming up right after World War II, sort of, going into the baby boom era. What were those years like for you and your husband?
Well, we were busy, of course, and we moved back into the big old farmhouse when my children were young, and when Kaiser Town Square opened, it wasn't called that then, and there was a Capital drugstore started, and my children were old enough, I got a part-time job at the drugstore, and I could just walk out my house up the lane right into the back, through the back door of the Capital drugstore, and then just, I was really close to home, and my husband, of course, worked for the state of Oregon, and so that was our life.
How long did the farmhouse stay up?
Till 1961.
And that was when it was sold, and sort of the whole thing was subdivided. I see.
It was divided before then. My father passed away in 55, and my mother lived on until 61, and then we sold the farm, the rest of it. The rest of it had been pretty much sold off and all that.
So what were you doing when you met your husband?
I was in high school. I found out I met him when I was in high school.
What about when the two of you started dating? Did you meet at a beach wedding?
Yeah, we met at the beach, and my husband was in college. He graduated from Willamette in the late 30s.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So you came back. What was it that kept you right here in this little area?
Well, my father gave us a piece of on the front part of the land in the Walnut Orchard, a plot, and we built a house, which is still there. It's a white house at the end of Cherry Avenue. It's across from Domino's now, I believe.
I see.
And we built that house.
And do you still live there?
No. I moved. We moved just around the corner.
My understanding is when you moved to Kaiser, there wasn't electricity yet.
Oh yes.
In the house.
Oh yes. Yeah, there was electricity.
Oh, okay, but it was the street lights then that weren't there yet.
Oh, no street lights. Oh, no. When you left Salem, it was dark. There weren't any lights in Kaiser. Cherry Avenue didn't have anything on it until you got clear down to the end where the Reefus Farm was. I mean, there weren't lights like it is now. It was kind of scary at times, no lights in Kaiser, because farmhouses were back off the road, seemed like, and might be a little light here and there on a house, and that was all.
What was it like what do you remember thinking when they got the street lights strung up?
Well, everything came on so gradual, I can't really, can't really say, oh, wow.
It
just kind of changed and grew with what came along.
So what'd you do for fun when you were a kid? You mentioned playing on the farm.
I loved the farm. And I just enjoyed the creek. My father got me a beautiful mare, Morgan Black horse, when I was 12. And that was my life. I could get on her and explore Kaiser every afternoon, which I did. And there was a lot of exploring to be done then, and you could get around. I mean, you could go into the woods and things like that there and down by the river and watch the paddle boats, paddle stern wheelers go by and things like that. It was fun. That's what I did. I had a good childhood.
Tell me about the trips into town you would take with your dad.
Well, my dad owned a restaurant in town called Peter Pan. And sometimes on Fridays I'd go in with him because he had a room in the Oregon Hotel. And then I'd stay all night and work in the restaurant. I'd fold napkins because I wouldn't then go to Mickey Mouse Club at the Elsinore Theater on Saturday afternoons. And then come home with him the next day.
So do you remember when River Road was widened to four lanes?
Well, in a way I do, but I really can't say that I do.
At what point, what did you think when the idea of incorporating this, the idea of a city of Kaiser, of course, had been around for a long time?
Well, I'm not very political, and it was fine with me.
Mm-hmm. It's got to be wild, kind of looking at this area that you grew up your whole life. It transformed.
Oh, it has.
But it has. It's sort of a poco a poco, little by little.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And it's hard for people to realize what it used to be, what I remember, to what it is now. It's hard for you to even realize.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of this wasn't here, you know.
Sure. Do you remember, what was a moment that you remember sort of seeing, thinking, wow, how much things have changed? Was there a oh, wow moment or just?
No, because I've lived here, most of my life, and it just kind of, you grow with it. And if things change, it just changed, and that was part of it.
So did you end up going to high school? Where'd you go to high school?
Salem High School.
Salem mm-hmm. High School. What was the, and that would have been sort of coming into, whenabouts would that have been?
The
when
high
did you
school?
Graduate high school?
When did I graduate?
Mm-hmm.
1938, and we went to 2 years where Myron Franks was. That's where the old Salem High School was.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 1 year in the new house. Salem High School. Of course, it changed to North Salem High School in 1954 when the South Salem High School was built.
What did you and your friends do for fun in high school?
Well, I rode the school. We had a school bus
mm-hmm.
that took us in, and we had to come home every afternoon, of course, so it couldn't take part in any after-school things. And in those days, you just didn't run into town like an evening or something like that. You didn't have cars to do that, or the gas, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So my fun, I say I had a good childhood, was coming home and was riding my horse. That was, and I didn't care about, I didn't know anybody in Salem until I went to high school there and all. So my life was on the old farmhouse, around the farmhouse and all around Kaiser, and I was perfectly happy.
Now, when did you get your first car?
Well, when we got married, I guess.
What kind of car was it?
It was a 96 Ford Coupe. Black.
So where did you and your husband take trips around the area? Did you ever go on car rides?
Oh, yes.
Where were some of the places you liked to go?
Well, we like to take off for the beach quite often.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the World's Fair in San Francisco. We'd go to Reno. Just around.
You guys got all over, huh?
Yeah.
you mentioned you weren't political, but just from a philosophical standpoint, what did you think of this agrarian sort of rural transition to urban? Did you think that was good
for the
community?
Well, I didn't, tell you the truth, you know, it didn't really dawn on me that was happening.
Mm-hmm. So how many children did you have?
Three.
What were their names?
Stanley, Alan, and Janice.
And they were raised right there in that house,
more
huh?
or less. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They have fond memories of the old house.
What do you remember taking the kids to do when they were younger?
Well, we went camping a lot. We'd go to Silver Creek Falls a lot. Just little, and to the beach. We'd take them on trips to California. Went to Disneyland with them when Disneyland the first year they opened.
Oh wow!
Yeah.
Do you have the ears still?
No, wish I did. But when we were there that time. You want to hear about it?
What's that?
When you want to hear about a trip to Disneyland in 55?
Let's hear about it.
We went. And we just had my daughter. The boys had stayed, they were in school, so they had to stay home with my grandparents. She was about 4 or 5, and so we went to Disneyland. And we're walking around, and some men kept following us, and finally my husband went out and asked him why. He said, well, they chose us as the family of the day.
Uh-huh.
And then they had a program in the evening over at a show house or something where you answered questions, and I answered the question right, and another woman, we won prizes. And I have a recording of that. And there was a comedian called Wally somebody, and she had my daughter come up, and I have a picture of it. And then he shot a gun, and it scared my daughter so much. She started crying, of course. But and she hasn't liked guns ever since. But it was a fun trip. It was, and I have pictures of Disneyland in 55. It looks a lot different now.
Do you remember
keys to the kingdom, too.
Oh, cool. Did they unlock anything?
No, they didn't.
do you remember some of the bigger, this area, as you know, has had its share of floods over the years.
Oh, yeah.
Was the family, were you far enough from the river and the creek that you ended up?
Right, I understand where our house is situated in the big flood of 1861 that was so devastating. The water just came around here and didn't get into the house. But every year when it rained, you knew it was going to be, there were going to be places in River Road and Cherry Avenue where the water would go, we call them through the draws, be water, and then water. And I'd know that I couldn't get to the pasture because there'd be water back there in a certain place. But none of the big floods even later on came around this area where we lived, fortunately.
Do you remember what did it look like on, you know, if you were to drive down River Road in the middle of, say, a big flood during the 60s? What would it have looked like?
Well, okay, if you went down River Road, you know, before you got to Sunset, you knew there'd be water going through there. That was the natural place for it to go. Of course, then it went across behind and through past Cherry Avenue and on back down to the creek. And then you'd go up to where Burger King is now, there were two ponds. They'd be pretty full. And if we did have really cold weather and freeze, we could ice skate on them. Two or three winters that got cold enough, they could ice skate on those little ponds. But that's, you just knew there were certain places. And then where Kaiser Times is now,
mm-hmm.
the house on your right past the orangey house, I call it.
Mm-hmm.
That's where a friend of mine, Eileen Holden Johnson, that there was a draw there, and that was always full of water. So we knew whenever the river, before they put dikes in,
mm-hmm.
and the river rose, nobody ever even thought of building along the river until the dikes were put in. And you knew the water, there are certain places, that's where the water would go. And unless they had a devastating flood, those were the main ones that would fill, though. Every year we knew it. You could generally get through them.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Did you have any family friends who lost part of their houses or livestock or anything during those?
Now, a friend who lives off of Windsor Island Road, Barbara Baldwin Knighton, can tell you more about that. They had trouble with getting their cows sometimes through certain places where the water, because that's closer to the river where it would flood. But where we lived and where this house was, wasn't affected so much.
So you ended up, did you learn, you learned Spanish, didn't you?
Well, I didn't really learn it. I worked for the Foreign Language Department, did their typing and everything, and I could type it and all that, but I never had a chance to really get into learning it. But I absorbed enough to get by. But.
Can you give me your best Spanish?
No, just como está, how are you? And adios.
So when you think about, so you've spent close to some, 80 years here in.
Pardon?
You've spent something close to 80 years here in this area.
Mm-hmm.
When you think back, what's maybe your pre-end of World War II, what's like your most pleasant memory of the area?
Well, let's see. That's kind of hard to say. I say everything kind of changed so gradually. You got used to not having it, and then you got used to doing it. I think the main, I don't know if there's anything special that I can really can't tell you about. A lot has changed, of course. I've seen a lot of changes.
Mm-hmm.
And I have had to accept a lot of changes.
What was, when you say accept, what's the one thing that comes to mind that was kind of hard to swallow?
Well, one thing was the dress code at the workplace.
Oh, yeah?
It went from where you took pride in what you wore, because you always work better when you look better, to where they could come in raggedy jeans and skirts up, you know, to wear, and that kind of was sad, and just the whole demeanor, and you started calling everybody for the first names, which I was brought up in the era where you respected and did things a little different. So it was hard to see that change. So I'm hoping that someday it'll go kind of back to it, but maybe it won't.
I should have worn my tie.
Well,
this has been the first installment of our Oral History Project. Hope you enjoyed it. And Ms. Franz, thank you so much for sitting down with us and sharing some memories with us.
Pleasure to do that. It was a pleasure.
All right. And that's it for today. Take care.